Did you know that the treasure that we're seeking is actually everywhere? And that's why we can't find it. When we deny this basic fact that everything is inherently embedded within the vast, smooth, seamless super matrix of the total absence, as it were. Everything, pure spaciousness. When we deny this fact that our treasure is everywhere, there's no place where it is not, then we think that it's somewhere, okay? And then we go on a treasure hunt. It's fair to say that we're all on a treasure hunt, and we have been on a treasure hunt. And how we motivate ourselves to pursue this treasure is the tale of sound and fury signifying nothing that signifies existence. And we use all sorts of motivational tactics to keep us searching for this lost treasure. We feel that there's a lost treasure somewhere because we don't realize that our treasure is everywhere. So by denying this basic fact, we feel we've lost our treasure. Somewhere there's some vast treasure, and I've lost it. I don't know where it is. I gotta find it. We're all like this, and we get this very interesting thing about the goddess of greed, as I call it, which is a motivational dynamic we use to con us, to scam us into searching ever more diligently for this lost treasure. Now, I've been scammed by that extremely badly, by the goddess of greed, who basically recruited me because I had such high psychic abilities. I could find anything. I was recruited by this goddess of greed to find the lost treasure, because she thought I could find it for her. And so, of course, actually, once I found it, she was going to take it and give me a percentage of it. And her story was that, well, she was like, God created her perfect except for one thing, and that she had to motivate someone else to find this lost treasure out of selflessness or something. And, you know, there's a whole spiel behind this thing. The goddess is very tricky. Very, very tricky. This goddess of greed saying, seek externally for this lost treasure. Okay, that's the goddess of greed. Get more, 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 more. Acquire all this wealth. Acquire all this external stuff. Build up your treasure, external treasure. And get more empowered and search more, 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 more. All the while, totally deluded that the real treasure is everywhere. So, I got severely scammed. What she said was, look, I know you can find the treasure, and I'm going to help you find it, but I cannot, there's certain restrictions on me, you know. And so she would say, do this, I'll help you with this. The thing is, I had to pay for everything. So I financed this incredible scenario. But I didn't even have any money, so I put it all on the future credit and everything. And she said, no, I'll pay it all back. There's one cat as soon as I find this treasure. Didn't say that, though. Yeah, it's very tricky. Very, very tricky. And very deceitful. So the upshot is I never got a penny back. And I'm still, you know, paying off all the bills, working it off. Never gotten a penny of help. And of course, when the goddess dumps you, when she can find someone else to, you know, search for this treasure, the idea of this lost treasure somewhere, whether it's the Yamashita's treasure, you know, lost Dutchman's mine, all sorts of lost treasures. There's this psychic complex. We feel there's some lost treasure somewhere. Alibaba's cave, you know, somewhere buried beneath the earth, hidden away. There's this vast hoard of gold and jewels and treasure somewhere. And so, literally, I tell you this, literally, people are treasure seekers. They may not admit to it. And there's some very desperate, clever treasure seekers out there. and usually it's the women who are even cleverer than the men, and they try to manipulate men to do the dirty work, the tough work, to find the gold mine for them, and then they have their goons to get rid of them once they do find it, off with their head, and so they get everything. That's what they want. So this is like the central scam of existence, actually, the treasure seeker scam, okay? And eventually you're going to get hit by it. There's no way around it. It's the central motif. When you deny where your treasure is, automatically you go on a treasure hunt to find it somewhere, and you'll never find it somewhere. But your supposition is automatically imposed upon you, a dynamic of supposition. I have a vast treasure somewhere, I just can't find it, it's lost to me, I need to find it. And then you'll pull into your lives all these motivational things. So I must have pulled into my life this goddess of greed who was motivating me to search like crazy. I mean, and then once you get like severely into debt and your life is just absolutely ruined, then you become even more desperate. And that's one of these ploys, is to make you suffer so bad that you do everything possible to find it. Because the whole idea we're telling ourselves is through a lack of effort or will on our part why we can't find this lost treasure. So if we just punish ourselves severely enough, we think we'll find it. Well, what I found out was I punished myself to such an insane extent that it became hit the point of completely intolerable, and I couldn't keep it up at that level, and I never found the treasure, you know, never found it. It doesn't exist. It doesn't exist anywhere. It only exists everywhere. And that's what the great gurus tell us, Longchenpa, for instance, and, you know, the great teachers tell us, hey, don't go searching for it far afield. You'll only find it right where you are because it's everywhere. As long as you're trying to find it somewhere, you will not realize that it's everywhere. So, I've already been through this horrific scam. I mean, it is just the worst thing ever. Unbelievable. The greed, the lust, you know, to find this treasure just uses you. You get used in the most incredible ways, heartless, cruel ways, and then discarded, thrown on the rubbish heap. You know, both figuratively and literally. And it continues on. It's just the central dynamic of existence is we've got to find this treasure. And we, through hook or by crook, we motivate ourselves. And that's so much suffering we bring upon ourselves. And again, at some point, everybody gets caught up in it. No matter how much careful you are, like I was very careful, I still got caught up in it. Because the goddess of self approached me, you know, and was so incredibly, quote, helpful, and upfront seemed to be the most wonderful, you know, possible being in all of existence, and yet actually was all a fake, you know. When someone thinks that you can find them infinite treasure, you know, just the lost treasure, imagine how nice they're going to act towards you. Yeah, can put on an incredible act. Like you're the most wonderful person, the most helpful person. They're so glad they found you. On and on and on and on and on, right? And so you get this mad rush of like you think that you're super valuable and worthy. You know, it just builds you up to an incredible extent. And then you start having to, just a little thing. Can you just do a little thing for me? Can you find this? Can you find this? So I went on a treasure hunt finding stuff. I had an incredible ability to find stuff. I was practicing. I mean, if I get up in the morning and then this psychic complex would say, and you need to find this, exactly this, nothing other than that. And so I would meditate, and then I was able to then pinpoint a location, and then I would go there, and exactly that thing that I was told to find would be right there. You know, just the most oddest stuff imaginable. So I was an incredible scavenger. But I finally found out that the whole thing was a complete scam. What they were doing was trying to train me so then I could find the great lost treasure, you know, in the world. The great lost treasure. And there is no great lost treasure in the world or any place. It's not any place. It's everywhere. It's already everywhere. It's the ground of being. That is the great lost treasure. And it's really never been lost because where can it hide? Where can everywhere hide? So the brutality of this scam is just off the charts. It just completely devastates you. Devastates you because you're always told that you know you've almost got it, and your reward. I mean, I was waiting desperately to be paid back because I was told I'd be paid back real quickly. Just have to spend on this and set this up, and never each time, no payback. Got to spend more. So you got to spend a little more, and you end up being, you know, just ruining your whole future, ruining your financial life, ruining everything. All for this greed to use you. Get used. But ultimately, we're just using ourselves. We're just pressuring ourselves, ultimately. This all these dakinis and goddesses of greed, you know, that this dynamic that can be act so kind and sweet and loving and caring for us. They're after the gold. They're after the lost treasure. Believe me. Absolutely they are. And the other face comes out and they turn into, you know, the most ferocious slave drivers possible. And like you're worthless if you don't sacrifice your life trying to find this treasure for them. Literally, they'll sacrifice your life. Absolutely they will. They want that treasure. They think that treasure is their salvation. And they're completely deluded, 100% deluded, which is really just a reflection of our own delusion of the desire to be greater than the prime creator, which means we're denying the prime creator, which is where? Everywhere. Which is what? Our everywhere treasure, our omnipresent, omnipotent treasure that everything already abides in. We have to deny that. And so by denying it, we feel we've lost this great treasure. And then since we're denying it's everywhere, we have to say, well, it's somewhere. So we feel like we can find it, or that we have to find it. We become obsessed with finding it, and it may be subconscious. What I've been able to do is bring this whole thing into the light and recognize it. I've been working on this for a long time, and a couple days ago, maybe even yesterday, I think it was yesterday, I saw it, you know, very clearly exactly what's happened. It's just like, wow, you know, mood of repentance, you know, saved me. But just it's just a brutal, brutal thing. Now, again, people think, okay, I can avoid this. No, you can't. You can't. Eventually, everybody gets caught up in it. No matter what you do, this scam is omnipresent in existence. Existence is this search. It is this search for a treasure that is lost. We can't find it. Where is this treasure? And you will get caught up eventually, and you will get used. You will get used very badly. This is what caused the great suffering. And when you suffer really terribly, then you will decide, you know what? I got to find an answer for this. Now, I've listened to many people tell me their sob stories about their lives. And I remember one man, for 4 hours, he actually held me captive. He tricked me and held me in a situation. He had this labyrinthine house, and I didn't know how to get out of there, actually, to tell you the truth. It was the most bizarre thing. And he was by the exit. I couldn't get out. And for 4 hours, he told me this story of his life. It was the most brutal thing, you know, just an incredibly terrible thing. And finally, he had finished it, and then I said, I gotta go, and then he let me leave. And when I left, he said, you know what? You're the best listener I've ever come across. It's unbelievable. Nobody's been able to listen to that before. And really, he was trying to kill me, because I almost died. It was such a shocking, draining thing on my system. But I have to say this. Anybody who tells you a sob story of how terrible their life was hasn't really suffered that bad, okay? They're lying. They're embellishing. It's a drama. The fact is, if you suffer really bad, you're not going to go over the details of it unless you're at a point like where I'm at, where I'm able to use the mood of repentance to such an extent that I'm able to get through this. But I don't even look back at my past much at all, and don't talk about this much specifics, and try not to. And for a long time, I never said a word about it because it was too terrible to even talk about. I wouldn't even think about, not even think about. Just have to spend 100% of your attention towards salvation, to getting free of it. So now that I'm doing these videos, I do talk a little bit about it in retrospect. But certainly, before these videos, I didn't say anything. I'm not going to sit and talk about some sob story. It's too terrible to talk about. Just find the answer, period. So those who are talking, they want to just tell people, oh yeah, I've suffered this, blah, 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 blah. And just, you know, that's what they do. They tell people all the time. They're not, they didn't really suffer that bad. If they were, they wouldn't be saying that. They wouldn't be talking about it. They would be focused like a laser on what is the answer? What is the answer? And that's what we're doing here. I'm still focused like a laser. What is the answer? Because this scam will get you. It will use you. It will burn you up. I mean, it will just gut you, utterly gut you. It will use you up. You'll get used up. Everybody though gets used up. They don't realize that their lives are nothing but a search. Search for a lost treasure. They can't find it. Nobody's ever found it. And nobody ever will find it because it's everywhere. How can you find everywhere? How can someone find everywhere? It's never been lost. You just give up the search and then you realize you are, the treasure is everywhere. It's beyond what you can conceive of treasure, because we've been conceiving of treasure as some finite thing that is located somewhere. But the real treasure is not located anywhere, because it's everywhere. And that's what realization is all about. So ultimately, to get free of the scam, you have to experience realization more than just talk about it. We're just talking about it, but that's a step. It's an important step. But you have to actually experience your treasure. And then you gain what's called credibility. Another thing that we're desperately searching for in this life is credibility. Now, that's another thing, problem I had. Unbelievable. I'll talk about it. This is some retrospective. As we're waiting for Ison, the perihelion, and all this kind of stuff, and the stuff that's to come, which is probably, probably very, very significant, but we'll see. Credibility. Everybody is desperately seeking credibility in this world, right? And I thought I had some sufficient credibility to try and help people with the central issue, you know, of this delusion they're in, of searching for a lost treasure. But what I found out was I didn't have sufficient credibility. I had built up credibility in Germany. I was previous life I was a German, and I built up tremendous credibility there, both in Germany and in Europe. And so the German people at that time was really very advanced. Germany was the most advanced place in the world, actually. I mean, scientifically, through materialism, chemistry, so many things. I mean, Germany, the medicine, the universities, the culture, the music, everything was very, 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 very forward-thinking and advanced, and had a lot of momentum, etc., which eventually, you know, rolled up into World War I and World War II. This was in the 19th century. And so Germans had this feeling that they were the most advanced, and I was like, you know, very, 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 had super amount of credibility as a German in Germany. And so I came to America, was reborn here in America, thinking that I had all this immense credibility. What I found out is here I didn't have sufficient credibility. The things that I said, I tried to tell people about the problem with comets when I was young, because I've known all about comets. I tried to tell them about the end times. I tried to tell them about the central delusion. I tried to tell them about, you know, all this stuff. And I didn't have enough credibility to pull it off. They just said, you're not credible. That's too much. I can't believe it. It crushed me, absolutely crushed me, because I didn't have sufficient credibility to warn people, to get them to listen to me. They wouldn't listen. So I felt I had this message, nobody will listen. And it's absolutely terrible. When you feel you don't have credibility, it is just like unbelievably terrible. Because nobody will listen to anything you have to say. When you lose credibility, then people just say, they're not credible, so tune them out. No credibility. And I lost it because the things I said were so way out there. Okay, so way out there that people said, no, you don't have sufficient credibility. So for me, what I have to do is I have to build up my credibility. Again, have to work on my credibility, building it up. And I got to the point that I was so frustrated that I started making mistakes. Before that, I didn't make mistakes. I mean, I was able to, and people just said, it's too much. I don't believe you. So, you know, who's credible? Yeah, who's credible in this world? Those who tell the truth or those who tell lies? Most people believe those who tell lies. Yeah, there's a treasure out there. Yeah, I'm going to help you find it. And they fall into that trap, right? Fall into that trap. Now, for me, in order to build my credibility up, I felt if I could find some great treasure, I could use that to help build my credibility back up so people would listen to what I had to say. So I got caught, you see, I got caught in this terrible situation where I had the truth, I had the right message, people didn't believe me, so I lost my credibility. I wanted to build my credibility back up, then I became vulnerable to the treasure search, and I was exploited by this goddess of greed who mercilessly exploited me, really to find the treasure for herself, you see. But I felt I needed it to build my credibility back up. See, so best of intentions, but this fatal flaw of actually not having enough credibility. So how do we get sufficient credibility to actually speak the truth in this world? There's only one way. There's only one way, and that is to actually experience what is credible. Okay, and what is credible? What is credible is that this, our treasure is everywhere. That is what is credible. It's the only way. Anything short of that, and you will lose your credibility in this world eventually, and you'll tumble. And I believe me, I've been there. I've been in a place where I was super credible and everybody believed what I had to say. And then I flew too high as far as to truth, and then nobody believed anything I had to say and lost all my credibility. So I went from way up here to way down here with super amount of credibility to like no credibility. And it's a completely horrendous thing to go through, actually. So, you know, the last couple days I finally realized, you know what? No matter what anybody says, I still have a little bit of credibility, and that I can admit to myself I have a problem, a continuity problem. Okay, so I know that's credible. All right, there's something about you. Nobody has zero credibility because you can say, you know, hey, you know what? I don't have any credibility. I need to work on it. That's a credible thing to say, isn't it? I need to restore my credibility. That's a credible thing to say. So nobody can push you down to zero. And that's what I realized the last couple of days. Nobody can push you down to zero. It's impossible. And from that, there's been a rebound effect. And a couple of days ago, I was like more assertive than I've ever been, that I can remember. And you know, I felt a resurge of credibility within myself. And I was able to, I realized I can stand up to so many situations and push back. You know, just amazing, amazing, amazing strength you get. The spiritual strength. You get the spiritual strength to stand up to the entire world, actually. But you have to realize that nobody has zero credibility. Okay? It's impossible to have zero credibility. Possible. Because you can admit that you've lost your credibility and that you need to restore it. And how you do it? By realizing the treasure reality. The treasure is everywhere. That's not zero credibility. All right, that there's a little bit of credibility there, right? So what I found is that what people try to do is they try to push you down to zero credibility. And when they do that, they have power over you. When they don't want to believe what you have to say, they try to make you feel like you have zero credibility. Then what I realized was, I don't have zero credibility. I have some. That which means it invalidates their strategies. It invalidates them. But they've been like sitting on me, the world's been sitting on me as if I had zero credibility, which is not true. It's not true. And then that the world suddenly begins to lift off of you when you realize this. So there are these like realizations that you can have that can pull you out of a deep depression, a severe situation, feeling that you'll never restore your credibility, etc. It's not true. It's not true. You can have this experience. So I'm not like I used to. I used to be able to know exactly what's going to happen in the future. Now I don't have that certainty. You know, I've so much lost my own feeling of credibility that I'm I don't have that capacity anymore. Because if you really did pinpoint stuff, then people will be after you. Big time. Big time. I don't have enough credibility to stand up to that. The last thing anybody wants to hear is somebody who can actually predict things with total accuracy. The whole world absolutely hates that. Absolutely hates it. And will refuse to believe it. Because they're afraid then that truth still exists, and that, you know, that there is no lost treasure, you know, and your treasure is everywhere. I mean, there's a whole house of cards that comes tumbling down when you can actually predict the future and know what's going to happen. The whole thing collapses. You just realize it's all a scam, very easily. So, because of the continuity problem, people want to think that their future is variable. In other words, they might find the treasure, right? They don't want to be told, no, I know, I can see for sure you're never going to find it. They say, no, see, I might find it. Who are you to say? You have no credibility to tell me that. You know what I'm saying? So if I told people, look, no, you're never going to find what you're looking for, they'd say you have no credibility, because to them, they have to find it. So it's very difficult to teach in this world, because people will attack your credibility. Okay, and they chip away at it. And one of the ways they do is they tell you, well, why don't you predict events, you know? And then there's ways that you can get worse and worse. I used to be able to do that, and then I got not so good. And then as soon as you make one mistake, they're on top of you like a ferocious beast. Like a ferocious beast, and saying, you see, you're a liar, you know, you're a deceiver, you don't know the truth. What they're really saying is, when you tell me that I can never find my lost treasure, it's not out there, I can't find it, you're lying, you're a deceiver, you're wrong, I'm going to find it. But I'm telling you, the search for it always means you're searching for it somewhere, and you will never find it somewhere. That is a fact, okay? It is an absolute fact. It's a totally credible fact. It's everywhere. It's already everywhere. There's nowhere where it isn't. Never. That's a fact. That's a credible fact. But you have to be literally experiencing this in order to actually push this out into the world to any extent at all. Because people are going to attack your credibility to the utmost. Now, the great gurus, generally, they don't predict anything, right? Because then people get fanatically upset about it and attack their predictions and try to get the whole thing turned towards these minutiae and details that are off track. That's not really the point. It's not the point. So they tend not to tell us what's going to happen in the future. But at the same hand, here we are sitting with Comet Ison going on perihelion and going to its tail. As it goes around the sun, then the solar wind's going to push its tail ahead of it. So as it's heading out towards Earth on the outward bound, the debris tail is actually preceding it. And that'll reach just like December 7th or so, I believe. The debris field is actually, this comet is going right over the North Pole of the Earth, which is a very dangerous thing. Now, I have been shown by one of my gurus a scenario in which a comet goes around behind the sun and then comes out and then dumps right on top of my head. In other words, it crashes down on our head, which would be, you know, the North Pole, the idea of it goes right over Earth. So I've been shown so much about the future in symbolic ways that are open to interpretation. I have not been given specific dates or times or exactly what's going to happen. Because when you do that, then your credibility, you're putting your credibility at stake, and the teachers say, hey, it's not a good thing. That really tears you down. When you lose a sense of credibility, you become vulnerable to the scam artists who then will use you, your great gifts that you have in clarity and determination, to search for treasure for them, to search for wealth, whether it be, you know, in all sorts of scams. You get involved in scams. No question about it. You might say the whole world's actually a scam, all sorts of different ways. But you end up shouldering the entire burden for the users. There's those who are very skillful in directing you without doing anything themselves. they con you into thinking that that's all necessary and part of God's plan, and that you're just fulfilling your role, they're fulfilling their role, and once both fulfill their roles, then the treasure will be found and you'll be able to split it or something like that. It's subtle, it's tricky, and it's so tricky you can't believe how tricky it is. I mean, it's just taken me so long to see, you know, what it was really about. So, what is going to happen with Comet Ison? Well, eventually some comet is really going to hit us. Is it Ison? I don't know. Could it be? It certainly could be. But basically what I've been shown through many, many ways, through my gurus actually, you know, the top gurus that I've had access to, because I was in such bad shape, I was completely willing to, you know, focus on the truth and find answers. When you become really, really focused, the top gurus give you a hand. They show up. Like Jesus, Ananda Mahima, Ramana Maharshi, Longchenpa. They show up. They show up and help you. Because, you know, they're looking for those who are actually after it. You know, seriously after it. Not just joking around. Just shut up and go for it, because they're suffering so bad. They say, I have to find the answer. It's more important than breathing. You know, I have to find the answer. And they show up. So they have shown that there's going to be a problem with the comet. There's no question about it. Unmistakably so. Now, this 333-year cycle is very interesting, because the number 33 has been showing up for me just relentlessly. I'm walking up this driveway yesterday, very, you know, wealthy, beautiful home. I walk up this driveway, and there's these two little green clovers, and they're situated and together like this. I couldn't miss them, and I said, "What? How many leaves do they have?" Ah, three and three, three-leaf clovers, 3 and 3, 33. You know, just right there. Who put them there, and who aligned them there? You know, together like that. And it's just like, whoa, 33, 33. There is likely to be a comet that has a 333-year cycle. If you go back from right now to 13, and subtract 333, you get the 16, the 16 something, 1687, or I don't know. You have the Great Comet, that brought about the plague of Vienna, and rained down fire and brimstone and poisoned the waters, and it was a horrible climate change happened back there in 16 something. There was a very, very, very disastrous comet actually. Now, if you go back 333 more years, you get Comet Negra, which brought about the Black Death, and that was like 1347. So the other one must have been like 1680 or something. 1647, I think. 1347 was Comet Negra, 333 years, which, again, the Black Death was just the most horrific plague to ever strike this planet. And there are many, many accounts of tremendous disasters and Earth getting struck by stones and raining, you know, stones and fire and just so, it was brutal, really brutal, brutal comet. And the comet came right at that time. And then you go back again to, what was it, 781 or something, 333, 16, do the math, 1347, it would be 806 or something, 47, 33, 1, 4, something, whatever it is, 8 something, 7 something, lost track of it, 1347, So it'd be 8 something. 8:15? 8:15, go back to 8:15, and you go back again and again, you get to 15 AD, and you look at these times, and you can see that there was, most of these times, there were comets and problems. The records are spotty when you go further and you go back. The Chinese kept long records about comets, and they say there's definitely a correlation between comets and great troubles on this planet. The ancient people were empirical scientists, empiricists, which did observation, okay? You know, we have this idea that our ancestors were stupid. That's far from it. You know, we have an idea like cats are stupid or dogs are stupid. It's not true. Animals are stupid. No, they're not. Actually, cats are and dogs are incredibly acute observers. I've tested them out. It's amazing how aware they are. Okay, through observation. They're not troubled with conceptuality and imagination, all this stuff. They're just pure empiricists, observationalists. Okay, our ancient ancestors were incredibly keen observationists, and especially when it came to the sky. Because remember back then, we didn't have this, you know, this haze around the earth. The sky was like bejeweled, very clear. And they watched the sky. And they observed the sky, and they observed stuff. And so the reports that they, ancient people, gave, I absolutely trust those reports. Now the conclusions they drew is a different story. We're very sophisticated by scientifically finding out the causation of all this stuff, right? They didn't have that. They would tell stories about, well, the great god turtle came here, and the alligator in the sky. And they tried to use animals to create stories and various things. But as far as their observations about, you know, raining fire and the waters, red dust coming down, poisoning the waters, the fish dying off, terrible tsunamis, you know, impacts of craters, fireballs hitting, forests burning down, all that stuff, and many, many more, were accurate observations. They're just pure observationalists, and they just recorded, this is orally transmitted, this is what happened. The Chinese kept records for a long time, 1,500 years or more. You know, about comets. Each comet would come, they would log it and observe what happened. So the fact is that comets do bring extreme troubles upon the planet. Why? Now, the scientists of today are quite fat and lazy, and most of them thinking that they know everything, but they're far from it. And the truth of the matter is that comets can, they're now actually saying, I mean, not all, a lot of, some scientists are fantastic, you know, really, absolutely fantastic. I'm not anti-science at all. They've done an amazing job in a lot of ways. And some of them have got it right, actually. And they say that comets seed life on different planets. That is true. How is that possible? Well, they now know that a lot of anaerobic organisms, very simple types of bacteria and viruses and organisms, actually can be in a state, especially when it's very cold and there's no oxygen. They can travel for millions and millions, even billions of years on a comet. So the fact is, these comets are not just icy snowballs. There's a lot more to them than that. A lot more to them than that. They harbor all sorts of various microorganisms, bacteria and viruses and various organic compounds, etc. Now when they, that debris trail that they have, when they go around the sun, they're coming in the sun, they're burning off a lot of that stuff is in the atmosphere. Now, did you know that like 2 million pounds of cosmic dust actually settles on this planet every single day? Cosmic dust. Space is not without, it's not a vacuum in the total sense that there's nothing there. It's not an absence of everything. It's a vacuum, you know, in the way science talks about a vacuum. It is a lack of pressure and all this stuff. But you suck the oxygen. There's no oxygen, etc. But there is dust. There's gas. There is dust. And this dust trails from comets settle into the Earth. They go into the upper atmosphere first of the Earth, and they filter down onto the planet. Now, the thing is, you can get all sorts of different types of bacteria, viruses, microorganisms from comets coming down upon the planet, getting into the DNA of this planet. and changing things and bringing severe changes to this planet and bringing about the Black Death. Well, maybe they played a part in it, but there's a lot of evidence that's not the only answer. It may not even have been true. Look at Iceland. There was no rats in Iceland. Iceland got hit hard by the Black Plague. You know, there was no rats there. There's a lot very cold there. You know, the mechanism of transmission, the bacillus, whatever it is, couldn't have lived in those conditions. The whole story of the Black Plague doesn't quite add up, actually. If you look at it carefully enough, you know, it's quite likely it was caused by the Comet Negra, because empirical observations from people at that time says the comet did cause it. And so those people were not as stupid as we like to think. We think, oh no, we know what caused it. It was the flea from rats transmitted, blah, 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 blah. And so we know. So those people must have been crazy, the idiots. Not true, not true. It may be us who are the idiots, okay? And this is part of repentance, is realizing maybe we're stupid. You know, maybe we're more stupid than the ancients in a lot of ways. And I believe that's true. I really do. I believe in a lot of ways the ancient people were way wiser than we are and understood cosmic causation a lot better than we do. We've gotten so locked into this materialism that we've lost sight of cosmic causation. And comets play an absolutely vital role in cosmic causation. There's no question about it. And we've got ISON bearing down on us. And I'm telling you, it could really bring about, it could be a game changer. It could be a game changer. Comets are game changers, okay? And this one, if you look at there are various online software that show you the path of ISON. And as it's going out, it goes directly over the north pole of the planet. And the planet Earth could be anywhere, right, in its orbit around the sun. So what are the odds that ISON is going to go directly over the planet? You know, it's very slim odds, actually. Very slim odds. So it's exceptional. This is an exceptional comet that's coming in. So who knows what is hitched a ride on this comet, and what is in its interior, really. And people, they say, well, it's a snowball, icy ice. Now, they're not talking about H2O. You know, the ice there, the compounds are, you know, maybe a little bit of water, but there's a lot of other, you know, compounds in there, which when the comet gets close enough, the dust trail's heavy, the debris trail's heavy enough, turn into all sorts of things in the atmosphere, combine with the hydrogen in our atmosphere and the various, you know, gases in our atmosphere, and can cause an incredible amount of problems. For our atmosphere, could poison the atmosphere, can poison the water, can poison the fish, the animals, the plants. It can cause a nuclear winter. The dust can cause like a nuclear winter, severe climate change. It can cause a plague from these viruses getting into people and recombining recombinant situations, starting off with birds who are often up in the atmosphere, the higher air, getting sick from the cosmic dust coming down with these super, super tiny, you know, microbes and bacteria and viruses coming down through the atmosphere, recombining, gets transmissible, and we have no defenses against it. Comets are killers. Comets are killers, I'm telling you that. So I've been warned severely about a coming comet by my great spiritual teachers. And they haven't given me, like, you know, specific information, probably to shield me. But it's coming. It is coming. And whether it's ISON or not, I don't know. But something is coming. So how do we survive such a situation? And there's a way. And I've been shown that too recently by reading the teachings of Lan Chenpa, which I find to be, you know, the most extraordinary teachings. That just, you know, it's like postgraduate stuff. You know, it's just a wow. It's just a total wow. I just like can't even describe it. It's just amazing, really amazing. Just the honest, direct. Of it all, It's just, there's just no guile there at all. You know, it's just 100% pure, pure direct sharing of truth, just pure. And he just says, whoa, you know, just how amazing is that? You don't come across that, you know, it's just something, it's just like, wow. So, through reading that, to absorbing it, to appreciating it, to feeling it, to getting it, I've recently seen the whole existence, what a scam it is. Death, aging, all of this, total scam, total scam. And the fact is, easily, we can have everything, we can dwell in a situation where everything is completely, vibrantly healthy and fresh, constantly. No death, no aging, no sickness, no vulnerability, nothing. Everything that we're seeing is only a story that we're making up to try to manufacture false evidence that these things are not abiding within the pure spaciousness already. We look at things and the tree aging, we say, well, how could this be abiding in pure spaciousness, which refreshes itself continuously? We say, it can't possibly be. It must be outside of everywhere, right? It must be somewhere else. Otherwise, how could it be aging and getting old and dying? But this is only because we want it to. You see, everything, all of this death and aging is our desire to see ourselves as outside of everywhere, as someplace other than reality. All of it. All of it. And so, it doesn't have to be that way. We can literally decide that we don't need to do that. And when we accept that everything is abiding in the everywhere-ness of reality already, always has been, there's no reason to see things as aging and dying at all. Or having needs, you know, I have needs, I have to go find it, search for it, you know, find the food, the treasure. No need for it at all. That's how you can dwell in the death-free realms. Easy. I've seen it. Easy. Piece of cake. Once you see what this is showing, it's a movie that is taught, we're lying to ourselves by thinking that this, oh, this is evidence that this is not abiding in pure spaciousness. It's not true. It is abiding in pure spaciousness. That's what Longchenpa points out to us. It all is, no matter what ornaments we want to imagine. Okay, even the ornament of this death and sickness and aging and everything, that is still abiding in pure spaciousness. But once you see that, you don't need to try and deceive yourself but through all this death and aging. You don't need it. Don't need it. So, I've literally seen how simple and easy it is to drop this and dwell in the death-free realm. Piece of cake. Piece of cake. Everything there is refreshing itself. It's falling into itself and being reborn every instant, refreshed, continually refreshed, vibrantly present, without a trace of age or sickness or death or vulnerability at all, without a trace. Totally easy and simple. So that's how to escape the problem of the comet. It literally is this high teaching of everything, let everything fall into itself, as it were. And the realization that everything is already abiding in pure spaciousness. You put this together in this gestalt of wholeness, and you can literally get it. You see it. You say, ah, oh, I recognize what this whole thing is about now. Totally unnecessary. I'm just trying to fool myself, which doesn't do anything. We're just trying to fool ourselves into thinking that it's possible that we can be separate from everything. From the everywhereness of pure spaciousness. We cannot be separate from it. But this world, all these forms of impermanence, of sickness and aging, gives us an illusion, a mirage, like we think, yeah, we are separate. We are separate. Because this stuff couldn't be embedded in pure spaciousness and still be dying, right? We're just trying to fool ourselves. And so when we're willing to give up this trying to fool ourselves, then dwelling in a death-free situation is easy. Now, it's possible to actually be in this world and have everything around you be vibrantly healthy and not aging or sick or anything. It is possible that there can be these zones in the world where, like, a true spiritual master could be in a certain place in this world, and around them in a large area. Literally, it's a protected area, and no harm can befall that area. Even you try to drop an atomic bomb or a comet on it, it can't be hurt at all. Cannot be hurt at all. That is the truth. I saw it, absolute truth. Now, can this happen? I don't know. It could. It could. Will it happen? Possible. It is possible. Like for me, I could easily dwell in such a place now. Easily. If there's a spiritual master, true spiritual master, and they have this place of sanctuary where nothing bad can happen, no harm can befall anything there, I could easily go to such a place and fit right in. So you're not that far away from being able to do that. That is a fact. Or you could sidestep into sort of a quote-unquote dimensional shift or something. Easy. You just decide to drop this ridiculous charade that you're... Everything's already in spaciousness, so why not just experience this, ornaments that are beautiful and undying and see the perpetual freshness of everything, the perpetual dwelling in spaciousness that's always there every single moment. Why not just see that? Why not do that? There's no reason not to. So there is a way to sidestep any catastrophe. There's no question about it. Doesn't matter. The whole universe could blow up and it wouldn't touch you. Absolutely wouldn't touch you. that is literally, and it's not difficult to see that. It's not difficult. We just have to look in the right direction. When I saw it, I just said, oh, aha. I said, oh, that's obvious. Wow. Yeah. No big deal. Yeah. Of course everything's already in spaciousness. What was I thinking? You know, crazy. So, there could be areas of refuge in the world. There could be areas of refuge. Spiritual master can provide those areas of refuge. And you won't get sick. You will not get sick. You won't even have to age. You won't even have to feel tired. You know, you just, absolutely not. Because you will feel that you're being perpetually born again. Perpetually refreshed, constantly being refreshed in the fact of pure spaciousness. You know, there's this constant nowness, constant freshness, you know, incredible freshness. It's always perfectly fresh. And you're not trying to make it seem otherwise, right? You're not trying to alter the nature of reality by giving evidence to the contrary, by being tired, by being aging, by dying, say, oh no, I've lost my freshness. I've lost my freshness. In other words, you're saying reality has lost its freshness. It's not fresh anymore. It's not perpetually, spontaneously fresh. Reality is always fresh. Always, always fresh. So we are not without help. We are not in the box we think we are at all. Not at all. But this has to be seen, has to be seen. So we're trying to see this before the comet, this comet gets here, any other comet. Eventually a comet is going to come. Some say, you know, it's the great, you know, Nibiru Planet X, some comet or something like that. Eventually that comet is going to come, and soon, actually, and soon. Now this ISON, it seems to be meeting so many parameters, you know, that just fits the 4-4-4-4-4-4. It's just unbelievable how many, that motif is coming up so much. And, you know, we'll see very soon, won't we? We'll see very soon what's going on. But here's the thing, that it could be a very progressive, gradual situation. There could be some impacts. You know, I think there probably will be some impacts here on the Earth, as there have been past comets, you know, that go right over the Earth. Those are the ones to look out for, okay? And this ISON, if it survives the perihelion, it's going to go right over the Earth. And, a severe X-class flare from the sun, critical mass ejection, as ISON's going directly towards the Earth, following ISON like that could blow its tail, you know, right into the debris field, right into the Earth, as a matter of fact. We've seen as ISON came in towards the sun, how an X-class flare just ripped its tail off and sent it shooting away like that. It's like it that pushes the debris field around, okay? So scientists are saying, don't worry, folks, everything's fine. No, they don't know what they're talking about. They really don't. I mean, they're just lazy people. Because what if a severe X-class flare, you know, just hit that debris field, okay? Send it right towards the Earth. What about that? You see, and the idea there's nothing in the debris field. If it fragments around the sun, how can you say there's nothing in the debris field? There's going to be plenty of stuff in the debris field. There could be trillions of stones in the debris field. Okay, having those raining down on the planet, it's the atmosphere of the Earth could get hit severely. And all sorts of stuff can happen with interaction in the atmosphere. So, and then things can filter down. Diseases and plagues can filter down from that debris field, okay, and start happening as time goes on, start developing, and then start spreading. We're told in Revelation of the Bible how there's going to be these afflictions poured out upon the earth, okay, and they're going to, it's kind of called the Great Tribulation. A lot of different stuff. There could be, of course, if large enough debris hits the ocean, you're going to have tsunamis. There's no question about it. You're going to have tsunamis. You're going to have severe dust in the atmosphere from the impacts. You could have dust just simply from the debris field of fine dust itself. And on and on and on and on. It's a domino effect. Okay, comets cause domino effects. Now, we're also told in the Bible that this end of the age, the catastrophe that comes upon the earth is going to be the worst ever. Never been such a bad catastrophe. That's what it says. In all of history of the planet, there's never been such a bad catastrophe. And they said if it's not, the days are not cut short, there's no living life form on the planet would survive. So, you know, that's like, wow. that means, you know, hey, could be a very bad situation. And then say, you know, but help is available. Help is coming. We're told that Jesus Christ, which Christ actually refers to this pure spaciousness, complete, smooth, plenum, super matrix. Christ means the one, Jesus, the one who represented the super matrix to the world. The super matrix is God, okay? The super matrix is God. This crazy matrix we've imagined is not God. It's existing within the super matrix. So when people talk about the matrix, that exists within the super matrix. All ornaments exist within the super matrix. Everything that appears is just an ornament, a decoration of the super matrix of pure spaciousness, which is God. The plenum, the perfect plenum, that is God. Totally smooth, completely smooth. No attributes, in other words, totally smooth. So Christ refers to oil, the smoothness of oil. It's a term that's used to refer to this super matrix. So Jesus the Christ was a representation on this planet to direct us to this, back to the super matrix, okay? To accepting the fact that everything has always been in it and can never be separate from it. Where we're sinful, we believe that we can be separate from it. That's sin, originally that's sin, okay? Original sin, the sin of origin, saying no, we're not yet established in it, we're trying to become established in it. That's a total delusion, isn't it, right? Saying, oh no, we're on the path to enlightenment, we're on the path to being established in the super matrix, we're not established there yet. We have to go through all sorts of soul growth and lessons until we finally learn to establish ourselves in the super matrix. That is a total lie. Everything inherently is already perfectly established in the super matrix, okay? Can't be otherwise. Anything other than that is total delusion. So these great teachers come into the world, and Jesus the Christ tells us, hey, this is the truth, okay? So within that, he said he's going to return at the end of the age to help us out in some way. Help us out. You know, people have different ideas what's going to happen. Some say there's a rapture is going to happen. Well, what is the rapture? It could be a dimensional shift. It could be places of refuge. It could be a lot of stuff. And whether it's pre-tribulation, mid or after, or through the whole period actually, etc. Again, there's a lot of different opinions. But from my understanding, what I've gotten is that the return of Jesus Christ is very soon actually. very, very soon. And then what happens at that point? Well, we'll find out. It will be progressively revealed to us of what it's about. But again, it's totally simple. Again, totally simple. It's just the acceptance that everything is a terrible, ridiculous farce of believing that somehow we're on the road to establishing ourselves in the supermatrix. Nothing is on any road to establish itself in the supermatrix. Everything is inherently already established in the supermatrix. It's always been that way, always will be that way, so nothing has to happen. You don't have to do anything for truth to be true. Nobody does, nobody does. So it's this type of understanding that aligns you with Jesus. It's called the love of truth. If the love of truth is not in you, then how can you be raptured? How can you be saved? You cannot. We are told that those who will be saved have the love of truth within them, okay? Otherwise, you're still going to want to be searching somewhere, and you won't you refuse to recognize that it's everywhere. Your treasure is everywhere. You say, no, it's not here. I don't have it, you know? And you're going to surround yourself in an environment which also says, I don't have it. In order to say, I don't have it, you have to have an environment that also doesn't have it. Because if it was right in front of you, you'd say, I do have it, right? So we insist upon environments which seem devoid of any treasure, right? We insist upon it. What we need to do is toughen ourselves up for truth instead of trying to toughen ourselves up for lies. What we've been doing is toughening ourselves up for lies, saying, I got to have this environment that's there's no treasure there, you know, no treasure there, and so I know I have to seek somewhere else because I don't have it. I know that I don't have it, we say. I know I don't have it. I know it's lost. So how could it be lost if it's right all around me, you know? So, of course, we try to toughen ourselves up by tough circumstances. We need to do the opposite. We need to toughen ourselves up for truth. Okay, toughen ourselves up for truth, which means that the treasure is everywhere, which means we need to be in an environment which is, we look out and say, oh, what a treasure. I mean, what an incredible treasure. I feel everything around me is like a beautiful, beautiful treasure. It's right here. The treasure's right here. And then that helps you realize, hey, I do have it, and it is everywhere. We need to be toughened up for that by allowing ourselves to be in more and more beautiful situations. Beautiful, where we feel that the treasure is just, we were just in such a treasured place, you know, absolutely. Gorgeous, beautiful, treasured place. Stuff is not sick, it's not dying, it's all this stuff. That helps us. That toughens us up for truth. Toughens us up for truth. So that's how I see the future. That's how I see Jesus helping us. Tough love is toughening us up for truth, which is toughening us up for the realization and acceptance that our treasure is everywhere. Always has been, always will be. We can't lose it. We cannot lose it. It's total treasure. Everything shares in this same treasure. Everything. Nothing is separate, never has been. And so this realization can dawn on us because these great teachers have had this realization. They experience it. So I trust them. I know it will happen to those who love truth. It will happen at some point. Once you've been toughened up for truth, this realization will dawn. It will dawn. I don't question that. I know it will. I don't know when, but it will. Because it's already the case. How come it's already the case? Not invariably be accepted. Truth has to be accepted, so it will happen, and it can. And why not let it happen soon, right? So, let yourself be toughened up for truth, which means let your circumstances get really good for you, really good, really. So you feel, wow, my circumstances are just a treasure. You know, I just feel this love. Just say, oh my God. Just everything seems so beautiful and incredibly nice, and just wow, and easy. See, we don't have to strive to find our treasure. It's everywhere. The more we're trying desperately to find it, you know, the more we suffer, like I've been through, of trying to get enough, you know, capacity to locate where is it. it's everywhere, and therefore nowhere. Right? Nowhere in particular will you ever find it. It's everywhere. which means you can't make any exception, can you? Because as soon as you make an exception, you have subject-object duality, and you say it's not here, it's out there. And when you say it's not here, you have to be surrounded with this field of not-here-ness, right? Otherwise, you'd realize it is right here. So perceptually, you have to not be able to see it. And you have to not be able to find it easily, or else you'd say, wait a minute, it's right here. Right here, it's easy, it's right here. No, inherently, it's somewhere else. And it's always somewhere else. So we go through our whole life, and it's always somewhere else. It's never here, it's always somewhere else. It's a terrible, 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 terrible life. So, the great sages wake us up, help us realize it's everywhere. And they help us toughen up by helping put us in circumstances which are wonderful, actually. That's the toughening up process. Not terrible circumstances, but really wonderful circumstances. Now, we think that these great yogis, adepts, etc., you know, they lived in caves most of their lives, and oh my God, they put themselves through hell. Yeah. Not true. As a matter of fact, like in Tibet, I mean, caves were like the best places to live. Yeah, absolutely. I mean, they had caves that were just like, wow. You know, it's just wonderful, wonderful. Air, you know, keeps not too cold in winter, not too hot in summer. Keeps the snow, the rain off. Keeps the animals are not, the wild animals are not there, can't get you. And you're safe, you're protected. Everything's quiet and still. And you have your little fire, and you got your food, and you just sleep in a nice place. Very nice. Cave living was very, very nice. It's the people who are struggling to build their homes from stones and subject to floods and torrents of, you know, of earthquakes and all this stuff. Now, the earthquakes don't bother the caves, the floods don't bother the caves, all these natural disasters don't bother the caves. So, living in a very nice cave, it was a very, very nice thing. Absolutely, for those times. Sure it was. I looked at Lanchenpa's cave where he spent, you know, a great many years. My gosh, it's a wonderful cave. It's a beautiful cave. The stones inside it, everything is beautiful. And then looking out, he looked out over this vast spaciousness, mountain range after valley after valley, and then the distance, the high snow-capped mountain. I mean, just beautiful. My gosh, the serenity and the beauty, and just sitting there in a cave and looking out on that, you know, it's just like, how is that not super nice? It is super nice. Very fortunate, actually. So, you know, he was being tough. That's being toughened up for truth, in a wonderful way. Wonderful way. So, we can be toughened up for truth also by being put in actually wonderful circumstances. Don't reject or fight against wonderful circumstances. Okay. That's helpful. Very, 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 very helpful. Good fortune comes your way. You're put in better and better circumstances. That is actually the way. But not you fighting and trying to, you know, get some treasure out there. You know, you're a great treasure seeker. You're going to find the treasure. Allow the miracle, the grace of God to move you into better and better situations. And things come about in miraculous ways, and accept that you don't need to be some starving beggar. No, that's not it. That's trying to toughen you up so you search more for the lost, quote-unquote, lost treasure externally. So, you know, there's a whip on you saying, this is what happens when you don't find it, treasure. This is what happens when you don't search hard enough. You're suffering. You're miserable. You see, you're sick. That's what happens to you. You're beating yourself up. Beating yourself up needlessly, because you're being asked to accomplish the impossible, which is to find everywhere, somewhere. It's impossible. So don't beat yourself up. Except be toughened up for truth. That is the way. Right now, accept that mantra, accept that mantra, accept that truth, and accept your good fortune, all right? Because now is the time when we need the good, great, good fortune of God's grace to move us towards this death-free realm which is actually a very simple recognition away for us. That, I'm telling you, witnessing to that, that is the truth. Very simple recognition. And it can happen any moment. You just recognize, oh my gosh, I can see how, you know, everything can arise continuously fresh like that. I don't need all this nonsense, right? I don't need it. Don't need it. Okay. Toughen up for truth. That's it.